It all started with a mountain that was born as an active volcano 90 million years ago. It began as a volcanic pipe that stored 5,000 feet high and 3 miles wide above a stark and barren landscape. Like some mad prehistoric fireworks, burning lava burst from the top and flowed down the sides as far south as Bermagui and to Turos in the north. This volcanic activity and heat created new rocks and minerals. Among these minerals was gold. Now only about 2,500 feet high, the mountain is called Gulaga by the local Aborigines. It was also seen by Captain Cook as he sailed north on his voyage of discovery in 1770. He thought it resembled a one-humped camel, so he named it Mount Dromedary. Gold was discovered near the top of Mount Dromedary, and as a result, there was much mining activity on the mountain with reef gold being mined. This would involve heavy machinery, crushers and stampers, quite different to the mining at Montreal. Over millions of years, our planet was constantly changing, and after the formation of the gold, and well before human life was on the Earth, there were some dramatic changes in climate. In the very wet times, rivers would flow down the sides of the mountain, across where Wallaga Lake is now, and out to sea. These rivers washed gold from the veins in the rocks, which was then carried by the water to the coast. It was this alluvial gold which was being sought by the miners on Montreal. Gold was discovered in beach shingle about 7 kilometres north of the Bermagui township. This discovery was made by two men, Henry Williams and L. Miniweather. Henry Williams was a Canadian from Montreal, and it was because of this that the new gold field was called Montreal. Once the discovery became known, the rush was on. Within 3 weeks, there were approximately 2,000 miners on the field. The people came by boat and also overland from nearby fields such as Mount Dromedary and Narragunda. An instant town was established. There were 3 hotels, various shops, a post office, a school, and other trades which all go to make up a settlement. The population of Montreal started to decrease after a couple of months and finally settled to about 700, with about 400 miners working the field. The main concentration of the gold-bearing shingle was approximately opposite to where we are now. Tunnels were driven inland from the beach under the roadway, and they are still there today. At this time, the area was devoid of trees. The miners would have used all the timber they could get for buildings and fires. What we see today is all regeneration. It's fascinating to imagine what the Montreal settlement must have been like, a bustling and busy place. All that is left now is a multitude of mine shafts. The miners would dig down about 30 feet to the beds of the ancient streams which had carried the alluvial gold from the mountain. It's noticeable that all the holes or shafts are rectangular. This points to the fact that they were not dug by Chinese miners. They would only dig round ones, without corners, as they believed evil spirits lived in the corners. The miners would work in pairs, one down the shaft, the other on top. When the riverbed was reached, one miner would fill a bucket with the earth. This was then hoisted to the top by a rope on a windlass. The contents of the bucket was then washed in a cradle or in a horse-powered puddling machine. These work in a similar way to a basic gold pan, in that the heavier gold would be caught in the grooves whilst the lighter material would wash away. The operator of the horse-powered machine would take a percentage of what was recovered. He was possibly the only one with a steady and assured income. As we walk along, we see a tunnel on our right. The miners here were tunnelling along the old riverbed, and the hole you see has an entrance a little further down the track. This is a beautiful spot, full of lush tree ferns and some attractive trees. The tree ferns have taken advantage of the protection offered by the old mine shafts to assist their germination and growth. In all, about 249 kilograms of gold has been recorded from the Montreal Goldfield over the 3 years it existed. In today's value, this represents approximately $14 million. Although, with three hotels in town, a lot of the gold would have been spent there and therefore would not have been accounted for.
Well, you've had a look at how the gold-bearing material is brought to the surface and worked over to find the gold within it, if in fact there is any. Now we're going to look at a bit of problem solving by the diggers, tackling another small mystery, because the diggers were constantly confronted by mysteries and none more challenging than where to find the gold. As you know, diggers had to buy and hold a license to dig their shafts. Hard work. Particularly as that license limited them to an area of only 12 feet square. Sometimes a small area could show great promise and accommodate a number of shafts, and we're going down to look at just such a spot. The challenge was how to make the most of an opportunity without doing more of the hard work than needed. This area we call our bottom adit. Notice the small tunnel? And it has some 9 shafts that all share a common exit hole to remove their material. And this was arranged using a party license, which cost them a bit more, where a number of diggers got together for their common benefit. For diggers, an easy problem to solve. And from the look of the site with its access ramp for a horse and cart, a lot of material was quickly moved. Incidentally, that old riverbed that was some 30 to 45 feet below the surface where we started our walk further up the hill is here at the adit, only about 6 foot below the surface where the diggers would have to work. Life would have been easier for them than for a lot of the others. Notice that small tunnel above the entrance. Now there's a recent miner that's moved in. In fact, it's an Asia kingfisher nesting tunnel, and we're quite happy to share with him. But now for a mystery that's not so easy to solve. In fact, 130 years on, and we're no closer to the answer than the day it happened. For you see, this is the case of the missing government surveyor, Lamont Young. Not just on his own, but with his assistant and three local farmers who had all sailed from the beach campsite on the Bermagui River, where they'd arrived only 2 days earlier, to look at a possible small gold field just a few miles up the coast, only halfway to Narooma. You see, Lamont Young had been sent from Sydney with his young German assistant to survey the new goldfield, which was to be called Montreal. He didn't even get to make a start. Arriving on a Friday, he introduced himself to the gold warden out at Montreal on the Saturday and went to check the reported field along the coast on Sunday morning, with the three farmers who had agreed to take Young and his assistant as they returned up the coast in the small sailing boat. And by midday on the Sunday, the boat was found on a small beach, deliberately damaged, not fit to sail, holes in the bottom, with clear evidence of foul play, and no sign of the five men who had set sail only hours before. Incredibly, the police investigating from Montreal Goldfield reckoned a regrettable accident had occurred, and it took quite some days before the whole matter was treated as a very dark deed, to say the least. Despite exhaustive searching over some weeks and ever-increasing evidence of foul play, no motive could be found, although all sorts of speculation took place. Many theories were put forward, including kidnapping, to provide boat crews for large ships, whose crews had jumped ship and joined various gold rushes around the country, to even an inside job, where the surveyor's assistant was nominated as the likely culprit. Well, the case attracted international attention. The surveyor's family back in England knew people in high places, like the Queen. And despite coronial inquiries that were conducted over the next 50 years as new evidence appeared to come to light, nothing further was ever seen or heard of Lamont Young, his assistant, or the three farmers from Maruya. A fascinating history of the whole strange affair has been documented in a book entitled simply Five Men Vanished by the author historian Cyril Pearl, who quite rightly refers to it as the Bermagui mystery, one of Australia's most notable unsolved crimes. For a crime it clearly is. And the reward poster you see here on our board alongside the trail offers £300 for information leading to, well, anyway, let's never give up. But the diggings hardly faltered. The matter settled down and speculation was to continue for many years to come. And yes, you guessed it, the beach where it all happened became known as Mystery Bay, now a popular tourist spot with many homes enjoying a delightful outlook. Although lasting only 3 to 4 years before the rush was seen to be finished and the population of Montreal largely moved on, with, I might say, more than a few staying in the general area and around Bermagui, interest in the goldfield kept surfacing, notably in 1938-39, when the Allen family reopened mining the black rutile sand on the beach where it had all begun. You remember the Great Depression? It encouraged quite a lot of interest in old diggings. The 1950s saw the reworking of sections of the Montreal field, and in the 1970s, the gold dredging company, Planet Gold, looked very hard at dredging the bay in front of the Long Beach. Now, however, all is quiet. And what of the future for Montreal Goldfield? Well, the bush has claimed its own, as you can see. The shafts remain as testimony to the incredible endeavours man will go to get a chance at sudden riches. And since gold was officially discovered in 1851, this was happening all around Australia. The south coast of New South Wales had its fair share of fields discovered, and although their moments of glory may have been brief, the Heritage Centre at Montreal is well poised to document, display and keep alive the goldfield heritage of this part of the east coast of New South Wales and present into the future details of the goldfields trail that would have fired the imaginations of diggers of that era.